of this case has now been presented and the attorneys have completed their summations. We now arrive at the time when you, as jurors, are to perform your final function in the case. At the outset, let me express my thanks and appreciation to each of you for your attention to the case. I'd like to commend counsel for the professional manner in which they have presented their cases and for their courtesy to the court and the jury during the course of the trial. Now, before you retire to deliberate and reach your verdict, it's my obligation to instruct you as to the principles of law applicable in the case. You shall consider my instructions in their entirety and not pick out any particular instruction and overemphasize it. Generally speaking, these instructions consist of four parts. The first part deals with the general principles of law that apply in criminal cases. The second part describes the evidence you may consider during your deliberations. The third part is about the portions of the criminal code of New Jersey that you must apply to the facts you find in this case to determine whether the state has proven beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendants violated a specific criminal statute. Finally, the fourth part of the instruction tells you how to go about conducting your deliberations. You must accept and apply this law for this case as I give it to you in my charge. Any ideas you have of what the law is or what the law should be, or any statements by the attorneys as to what the law may be, must be disregarded by you if they are in conflict with my charge. Now, beginning with the general principles of law that apply in criminal cases, the defendants stand before you on an indictment returned by the grand jurors of this county, charging them with, as to defendant Munoz, murder by his own conduct, conspiracy to commit murder, unlawful possession of a handgun, possession of a handgun for unlawful purpose, and witness tampering. As to defendant Velazquez, conspiracy to commit murder, murder as an accomplice, unlawful possession of a handgun, possession of a handgun for an unlawful purpose. Now, the indictment is not evidence of the defendant's guilt on the charges. An indictment's a step in the procedure to bring the matter before the court and the jury. For the jury's ultimate determination as to whether the defendants are guilty or no of the charges stated in it. The defendants had pleaded not guilty to the charges. The defendants on trial are presumed to be innocent. And unless each and every essential element of an offense charge is proved beyond a reasonable doubt, the defendants must be found not guilty of the charge. The burden of proving each element of a charge beyond a reasonable doubt rests upon the state. The burden never shifts to the defendant. The defendant in a criminal case has no obligation or duty to prove his innocence or to offer any proof relating to his innocence. The prosecution must prove its case by more than a mere preponderance of the evidence, yet not necessarily to an absolute certainty. As I've told you, the state has the burden of proving the defendant's guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. Some of you may have served as jurors in civil cases where you were told that it's necessary to prove only that a fact is more likely true than not true. In criminal cases, the state's proof must be more powerful than that. It must be beyond a reasonable doubt. Now, a reasonable doubt is an honest and reasonable uncertainty in your minds about the guilt of the defendant after giving full and impartial consideration to all of the evidence. A reasonable doubt may arise from the evidence itself or from a lack of evidence. It is a doubt that a reasonable person hearing the same evidence would have. Proof beyond a reasonable doubt is proof, for example, that leaves you firmly convinced of the defendant's guilt. In this world, we know very few things with absolute certainty. In criminal cases, the law does not require proof that overcomes every possible doubt. If based upon your consideration of the evidence, you are firmly convinced that the defendant is guilty of the crime charged, you must find him guilty. On the other hand, you are not firmly convinced of a defendant's guilt. You must give the defendant the benefit of the doubt and find him not guilty. Now, the function of the judge is separate and distinct from the function of the jury. It's my responsibility to determine all questions of law arising during the trial and to instruct the jury as to the law that applies in the case. You must accept the law as given to you by me and apply it to the facts as you find them to be. Now, during the course of trial, I was required to make certain rulings on the admissibility of evidence, either in or outside of your presence. These rulings involve questions of law. The comments of the attorneys on these matters were not evidence. In ruling, I have decided questions of law, and whatever the rulings may have been in any particular instance, you should understand that it was not an expression or opinion by me on the merits of the case. Neither should my other rulings or any other aspect of the trial be taken as favoring one side or the other. Each matter was decided on its merits. Now, I may have sustained an objection to some questions asked by counsel which may have contained statements of certain facts. The mere fact that an attorney asks a question and inserts facts or comments or opinions into that question in no way proves the existence of those facts. You will only consider such facts which, in your judgment, have been proven by the testimony of the witnesses told you when we started, I explained to you that you are the judges of the facts, and as judges of the facts, you're to determine the credibility of the various witnesses as well as the weight to be attached to their testimony. You and you alone are the sole and exclusive judges of the evidence, the credibility of the witnesses, and the weight to be attached to the testimony of each witness. Regardless of what counsel said, or I may say, recalling the evidence in the case, it is your recollection of the evidence that should guide you as judges of the facts. Arguments, statements, remarks, openings, and summations of counsel are not evidence and must not be treated as evidence. Although the attorneys may point out what they think is important in the case, you must rely solely upon your understanding and recollection of the evidence that was admitted during the trial. Whether or not the defendant has been proven guilty beyond a reasonable doubt is for you to determine based on all of the evidence presented during the trial. Any comments by counsel are not controlling. It's your sworn duty to arrive at a just conclusion after considering all of the evidence presented during the course of trial. I'll now move on to the second part of the instructions and discuss the evidence that you may consider in judging the facts of the case. Now, when I use the term evidence, I mean the testimony you have heard and seen from this witness box, any stipulations, and the exhibits that may have been admitted into evidence. Any exhibit that has not been admitted into evidence cannot be given to you in the jury room, even though it may have been marked for identification. Only those items admitted into evidence can be given to you. Any testimony that I may have had occasion to strike is not evidence and shall not be entered into your deliberations. It must be disregarded by you. This means that even though you may remember the testimony, you're not to use it in your discussions or deliberations. Further, if I gave a limiting instruction as to how to use certain evidence, that evidence must be considered by you for that purpose only. You cannot use it for any other purpose. As jurors, it's your duty to weigh the evidence calmly and without passion, prejudice, or sympathy. Any influence caused by these emotions has the potential to deprive both the state and the defendants of what you promised them, a fair and impartial trial by fair and impartial jurors. Also, speculation, conjecture, and other forms of guessing play no role in the performance of your duty. As I told you when we began the case, evidence may be either direct or circumstantial. Direct evidence means evidence that directly proves a fact without an inference, and which in itself, if true, conclusively establishes that fact. On the other hand, circumstantial evidence means evidence that proves a fact from which an inference of the existence of another fact may be drawn. An inference is a deduction of fact that may logically and reasonably be drawn from another fact or group of facts established by the evidence. Whether or not inferences should be drawn is for you to decide, using your own common sense, knowledge, and everyday experience. Ask yourselves, is it probable, logical, and reasonable? It's not necessary that all facts be proven by direct evidence. It may be proven by direct evidence, circumstantial evidence, or a combination of the two. All are acceptable as means of proof. In many cases, circumstantial evidence may be more certain, satisfying, and persuasive than direct evidence. However, direct and circumstantial evidence should be scrutinized and evaluated carefully. A verdict of guilt may be based on direct evidence alone, circumstantial evidence alone, or a combination of the two, provided, of course, that it convinces you of the defendant's guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. The reverse is also true. A defendant may be found not guilty by reason of direct evidence, circumstantial evidence, or a combination of the two, or lack of evidence, if it raises in your mind a reasonable doubt as to the defendant's guilt. Now, as judges of the facts, you're to determine the credibility of the witnesses, and in determining whether a witness is worthy of belief and therefore credible, you may take into consideration the following: the appearance and demeanor of the witness, the manner in which he or she may have testified, the witness's interest in the outcome of the trial, if any, his or her means of obtaining knowledge of the facts, the witness's power of discernment, meaning his or her judgment or understanding, his or her ability to reason, observe, recollect, and relate, the possible bias, if any, in favor of the side for whom the witness testified, the extent to which, if at all, each witness is either corroborated or contradicted, supported or discredited by other evidence, whether the witness testified with an intent to deceive you, the reasonableness or unreasonableness of the testimony the witness has given, whether the witness made any inconsistent or contradictory statement, and any and all other matters in the evidence which serve to support or discredit his or her testimony. Through this analysis, as judges of the facts, you weigh the testimony of each then determine the weight to give to it. Through that process, you may accept all of it, a portion of it, or none of it. Now, if you believe that any witness or party willfully or knowingly testified falsely to any material facts in the case with the intent to deceive you, you may give such weight to his or her testimony as you may deem it is entitled. You may believe some of it, or you may, in your discretion, disregard all of it. Now, as a general rule, witnesses can testify only to the facts known by them. This rule ordinarily does not permit the opinion of a witness to be received as evidence. However, an exception to this rule exists in the case of an expert witness who may give his opinion as to any matter in which he is versed, which is material to the case. In legal terminology, an expert witness is a witness who has some special knowledge, skill, experience, or training that is not possessed by the ordinary juror, and who thus may be able to provide assistance to the jury in understanding the evidence presented and then determine the facts in this case. In this case, the state produced Dr. Daksha Shah as an expert in the field of forensic pathology. The state also produced Special Agent John Hauger of the FBI as an expert in the field of historical cell site analysis. You are not bound by such experts' opinions, but you should consider each opinion and give it the weight to which you deem it is entitled, whether that be great or slight, or you may reject it. In examining each opinion, you may consider the reasons given for it, if any, and you may also consider the qualifications and the credibility of the expert. It's always within the special function of the jury to determine whether the facts on which the answer or testimony of an expert is based actually exist. The value or weight of the opinion of the expert is dependent upon and no stronger than the facts on which it is based. In other words, the probative value of the opinion will depend upon whether from all the evidence in the case you find that those facts are true. You may, in fact, determine from the evidence in the case that the facts that form the basis of the opinion are true, are not true, are true in part only, and in light of such findings, you should decide what effect such determination has upon the weight to be given to the opinion of the expert. Your acceptance or rejection of the expert opinion will depend, therefore, to some extent, on your findings as to the truth of the facts relied upon. The ultimate determination of whether or not the state has proven the defendant's guilty beyond a reasonable doubt is to be made only by the jury. Now, you have heard evidence that Michael Robinson has previously been convicted of a crime. This evidence may only be used in determining the credibility or believability of the witness's testimony. A jury has a right to consider whether a person who has previously failed to comply with society's rules as demonstrated through a criminal conviction would be more likely to ignore the oath requiring truthfulness on the witness stand than a person who has never been convicted of a crime. You may consider in determining this issue the nature and degree of the prior conviction and when it occurred. You are not, however, obligated to change your opinion as to the credibility of this witness simply because of a prior conviction. You may consider such evidence along with all other factors we just discussed in determining the credibility of a witness. Now, as you know, the defendants elected not to testify at trial. It is their constitutional right to remain silent. You must not consider for any purpose or in any manner in arriving at your verdict the fact that the defendants did not testify. That fact should not enter into your deliberations or discussions in any manner at any time. The defendants are entitled to have the jury consider all evidence presented at trial. They are presumed innocent whether or not they choose to testify. There is for your consideration in this case certain recorded and oral statements allegedly made by the defendants. With regard to defendant Munoz, there was testimony from witnesses who repeated remarks allegedly made by defendant Munoz. There are recorded statements of phone conversations with Courtney Chiaretto overheard by law enforcement, a phone conversation recorded by Courtney Chiaretto alone, several recorded conversations from county jails, an audio-video recording of a custodial statement made to law enforcement, and a statement allegedly made to law enforcement in the processing area of the prosecutor's office. With regard to defendant Velazquez, there is a recorded custodial statement made to law enforcement and another statement surreptitiously recorded by law enforcement at Velazquez's place of employment. It is your function to determine whether or not such statements were actually made by each defendant, and if made, whether such statement or any portion of it is credible. In considering whether or not an oral statement was actually made by the defendant, and if made, whether it is credible, you should receive, weigh, and consider this evidence with caution, based on the generally recognized risk of misunderstanding by the hearer, or the ability of the hearer to recall accurately the words used by the defendant. The specific words used and the ability to remember them are important to the correct understanding of any oral communication, because the presence or absence or change of a single word may substantially change the true meaning of even the shortest sentence. You should therefore receive, weigh, consider such evidence with caution. In considering whether or not such statement is credible, you should take into consideration the circumstances and facts as to how the statement was made, as well as all other evidence in this case relating to this issue, such as the custodial status of the defendant, whether he was aware that the statement was being recorded, whether the defendant was advised of his rights to counsel in silence, the physical, mental, and emotional state of the persons involved in the statement, the place where the statements were made, the persons hearing the statement, the persons recording the statements, the system for recording, retaining, and reproducing such statements, and any and all other circumstances in the case having a bearing on the statements. If, after consideration of all these factors, you determine that a statement was not actually made or that such statement is not credible, then you must disregard the statement completely. If you find that a statement was made and that part or all of the statement is credible, you may give what weight you think appropriate to the portion of the statement you find to be truthful and credible. There is also for your consideration in this case a recorded statement allegedly made by the defendants. It's your function to determine whether or not such a statement was actually made by a defendant, and if made, whether the statement or any portion of it is credible in accordance with the instructions I just gave you. You may consider all the circumstances surrounding these statements in making that determination with the following additional caution. I instruct you that, in this case, certain portions of the recorded statements have not been provided to you. You may only consider those portions of the statements which have been admitted in evidence and must not speculate as to the contents, the omission, or the reason or reasons for the omissions. Now, evidence of good character or reputation of an accused is always competent in the trial of a criminal action and is entitled to be considered by you. You, the jury, should consider all of the relevant testimony, including that relating to defendant Velazquez's good character or reputation. And if, on such consideration, there exists a reasonable doubt of his guilt, even though that doubt may arise merely from his previous good repute, he is entitled to an acquittal. But if, from the entire evidence in this case, including that relating to good character, you believe defendant Velazquez guilty beyond a reasonable doubt, he should be convicted, and the evidence of good character should not alter the verdict. Now, the parties have agreed to certain facts. The jury should treat these facts as undisputed. That is, the parties agree that these facts are true. As with all evidence, undisputed facts can be accepted or rejected by the jury in reaching a verdict. The parties have stipulated to the following. Number one, to the authenticity of surveillance video evidence. Number two, to the authenticity of all phone evidence, including cell phone company records and date and cell phone extractions. To the admissibility of S-126 transcript excerpts from a video recording of the children of Michael and Megan Black taken on November 9, 2015. To the authenticity and admissibility of defense exhibit Velazquez 120, that is Velazquez employer time cards for November 9, 2015. To the following translations of certain Islamic or Arabic phrases found in the evidence. Wallahi, Wallahi, I swear. Allah, God. Inshallah, God willing. Kufar, Kufir, a non-Muslim. Six, the parties stipulate that if called as a witness in this case on behalf of defendant Velazquez, Yomaris Acosta would have testified substantially as follows. I am Yomaris Acosta. I am a college student at Stockton University and have known defendant Edwin Velazquez since I was in sixth grade. Edwin Velazquez and his wife Deanna Velazquez assisted me and my single mother spiritually, emotionally, and financially while I was growing up. Mr. Velazquez has a reputation in the community as being honest, peaceful, and law-abiding. I'll now instruct you on the third part of the instructions on the portions of the criminal code